Welcome to the Danube Waltz, a cruise down the Danube River, which we took in September 2019. The Danube is Europe's second largest river, the largest being the Volga, and is located in Central and Eastern Europe, flowing through 10 countries, originating in southern Germany, then flowing east for 2,850 kilometers through Austria, Slovakia, Hungary, Croatia, Serbia, Romania, Bulgaria, Moldova, and Ukraine, before draining into the Black Sea. It was originally a trade route, and it probably still is, and a source of drinking water, and is now a major source of hydropower. On this trip, we visited Germany, Austria, the Czech Republic, Slovakia, and Hungary. And on this map, flights are shown with dashed black lines, road trips with solid red lines, and boat trips with solid blue lines. The major places we visited are indicated with black stars. So, as you can see, we flew into Munich and explored southern Bavaria and Salzburg by coach before driving to Passau to board our Danube cruise ship. Along the Danube, we visited Linz, Krems, Vienna, and Bratislava before disembarking at Budapest. At Linz, we took a side trip to Český Krumlov in the Czech Republic, and following disembarkation in Budapest, we spent an additional couple of days exploring the local area before flying out. Enjoy the presentation. On arrival in Munich, the first thing we did was head off to Schwangau, 135 kilometers to the southwest on the edge of the Alps. En route, we passed through some picturesque villages, many with Bavarian maypoles, which denote the local craftsmen's guilds. We ended up at Hohenschwangau village on the shores of Alpsee and overlooked by the 19th century Hohenschwangau castle, built by King Maximilian II of Bavaria, and the childhood residence of his more well-known son, King Ludwig II. There's been a fortress here on this hill since the 12th century. From the village, we walked up to the 19th century Neuschwanstein Castle, a Romanesque revival palace built by Ludwig II in honor of Wagner. However, Ludwig died before it was completed. Ludwig was known as the fairy tale king because of the various fanciful castles and palaces that he built. In fact, he spent and built quite extravagantly. He was devoted to Wagner, and something was homosexual and probably even insane. The castle is built on a hill at the foot of the Polot Gorge, over which Marienbrücke, originally a wooden bridge, was built by Ludwig. This is the view north from the castle, with Schwangau village to the left, and Forgensee and Bannwaldsee. Then we drove from Schwangau to Linderhof Castle, near the town of Ettal. En route, we saw many picturesque Bavarian homes. Thank you. The 19th century Lindehof Castle and the associated grounds, while the castle is the smallest of the three palaces built by Ludwig II, and the only one that he actually lived to see completed. It was inspired by the Palace of Versailles in France. We spent the second day exploring Munich, the Bavarian capital, with a population of 1.5 million. It's the third largest city in Germany. We visited BMW Welt, a combined exhibition and adventure museum built in between 2003 and 2007, adjacent to BMW's headquarters. This is the Nymphenburg Palace, a Baroque structure, a main summer residence of the former rulers of Bavaria and house of Wittelsbach. It was built in 1675 and expanded over the years. We then went into the old city, first at Odeonplatz, a large 19th century square. This is Feldherrnhalle, built in 1841 by Ludwig I. To honour the tradition of the Bavarian army, it's the site of the 1923 battle ending the Beer Hall Putsch, which was Hitler's attempted coup, and subsequently became a nasty monument. This is the 13th Church, an Italian high Baroque style Catholic church, built in 1663. And this is the Ludwig I equestrian statue at one end of the square. We then went on to Max Joseph Platz, a large 19th century square with the Maximilian Joseph statue, and the National Theatre, which you'll see in a second. That's a historic 19th century home, there we go, of the Bavarian State Opera, Orchestra and Ballet. We continued our walk through the cobble streets of the old city, quite picturesque. This is Holy Ghost Church in the old city, a Gothic Hall church, which dates back to the 14th century. We then visited Hofbräuhaus, the Bavarian state-owned brewery, founded in 1589. And of course we had to go inside and have a drink. Seems that many of the regulars here have their own personalised beer mugs, which they keep locked up here in the brewery. We ended up at Marienplatz, which has been the main city centre square in Munich since 1158. It's named after Mary's Column, but it's now dominated by New City Hall, built in 1874, and famous for its 43 bell clock chimes and 32 figures, reenacting the varied history of Munich, comprising battles and plagues. And I think you're going to be seeing a little bit of that coming up very shortly. is Mary's Column, a gold statue erected in 1638 to celebrate the end of Swedish occupation. And this is St. Peter's Church, the oldest church in Munich, dating to 1158. And finally, this is a Juliet Capulet statue, a bronze statue of Shakespeare's heroine from Romeo and Juliet, a gift from the city of Verona. Legend says that to touch Juliet's right breast to find true love. Our next stop was Salzburg in Austria. And it's the fourth largest city in Austria with a population of 157,000. It's located on the site of the Roman settlement of Luvelum on the river Salzach at the northern boundary of the Alps. It was founded in 696, originally for salt and gold mining. Hohensalzburg, a medieval fortress now overlooking the city, dates from the 11th century. And Salzburg became a centre for Counter-Reformation in the 17th century, resulting in lots of monasteries and picturesque Baroque churches. However, today, Salzburg is famous for three musical things: the birthplace of Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, 18th century, the setting for the movie The Sound of Music, and the carol Silent Night, which was composed here by Joseph Moore in 1818. We started off our visit to Salzburg with a walking tour around the historic Old Town, commonly known as Altstadt, which happened to be the name of our hotel. Altstadt is certainly very picturesque, with lots of cobbled streets, lovely architecture, and colourful stores. This is the first Salzburg Mosenkugel store, which has been making world-famous chocolates since 1890. And this is Mozart's birthplace, right in the heart of Altstadt, where he was born on the third floor in 1756. And on the other side of the Salzach River, we saw Mozart's residence, also known as the Dance Master's House, where he lived on the first floor from 1773 to 1787. A nice place to just sit and enjoy the Salzburg ambience is Mozartplatz, dominated, of course, by the bronze Mozart's monument erected in 1842. Of course, Salzburg isn't all about Mozart. Franz Schubert stayed here in August 1825. And of course, there's The Sound of Music, which was filmed here in 1965. Here at the Mirabelle Palace Gardens, which date back to 1606, a very well-known song routine was performed for the movie. Do you recognise those steps?
So flaunting, don't tease, so, re, fa, fa, la, ti, ti, do, mi, 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 so, so.
And this is Residenzplatz, with the 17th century Salzburg Cathedral on the right and the 16th century Neue Residenz on the left, with the prominent bell tower. Another famous song and dance routine in The Sound of Music was filmed here.
Strength doesn't lie in wealth. Strength lies in nights of peaceful slumbers. When you wake up, wake up! It tells thee all I trust I leave my heart to. All I trust becomes my own.
St. Peter's Abbey catacombs, dug out from the rock on which Hohenzollernburg Fortress is built, date from the year 700. Here are some more views of Hohenzollernburg Fortress from the city. And here are some views in the city along the Salzach River. We took the lift to the top of Munchberg, a 50-meter-high mountain to the southwest of the city, for a wonderful panorama over Salzburg. From here, we walked along the pedestrian path to Fortress Hohenzollernburg, and then back down again into the city. Back in the city, we went to Nonnberg Abbey, a Benedictine nunnery with a distinctive red onion clock tower, which was founded in 1712. This was where Maria was a nun. Then we drove 8 kilometres out of the city to Hellbrunn Palace, a Baroque villa built in 1613 to 1619 by the Salzburg Prince Archbishop as a day residence. You may recognise the gazebo, which was used in The Sound of Music for another famous song routine. On the way from Salzburg to Passau, we visited St. Gilgen, a picturesque village on the northwest shore of Wolfgangsee, 30 kilometres east of Salzburg. Here you can see St. Giles Parish Church with a distinctive clock tower. Though promoted as the Mozart village, Mozart never actually visited St. Gilgen, but his fat grandfather apparently worked in St. Gilgen. St. Gilgen also featured in the opening scenes of The Sound of Music. We also went to the town of Monsey, another picturesque Austrian town, 30 kilometres east of Salzburg, on the shore of a lake also called Monsey. Here we visited St. Michael's Basilica, formerly the monastery church of Monsey Abbey, which was founded in 748 and extensively rebuilt in the 18th century. This is where the wedding scene in The Sound of Music was filmed. Thank you. This is Passau, where we boarded our ship for our cruise down the Danube River. This city in southern Germany is called the City of Three Rivers, being the confluence of the Danube, the Inn from the south, and the Ilz from the north. Located on the border with Austria, Passau has a population of 50,000 and is the former ancient Roman colony of Batavis. It is now famous for its Gothic and Baroque architecture. Here is the Veste Oberhaus, a fortress on St. Georgeberg, a mountain on the left bank of the Danube. The fortress was founded in 1219 as a stronghold for the Bishop of Passau and is now a museum, youth hostel, restaurant and open-air theatre. And this is the Veste Niederhaus, an extension of the Veste Oberhaus, on a promontory between the Danube and the Ilz, built in 1367, creating a double fortress 700 metres long. We explored the old city on foot, walking down the cobble streets and through the town squares and along the Danube River bank. Unfortunately, Passau suffers quite severely from river flooding, and you can see evidence of this all around the town. And this is St. Stephen's Cathedral with a statue of King Maximilian I in Domplatz Square in the front of the cathedral. St. Stephen's is a Baroque-style Catholic church built in 1688 and houses the largest organ in Europe, which has 17,774 pipes, 233 registers and 6 consoles. We were fortunate enough to attend an organ recital there. And this is the Patron Saints Fountain outside St. Stephen's Cathedral. Here's the ship on which we'll be sailing down the Danube, the Viking Wilhelm. And as you can see, there are a number of Viking ships anchored here, some going upstream and some going downstream on various tours. Here we are, leaving from Passau, heading east downstream on the River Danube. And here you can just about see the juxtaposition of the three rivers. You can see the Inn on the left, and you can see the Danube in the middle, and the Ilz on the right. Quickly settled into life on board. It's not a big ship. There are only 190 passengers in 95 cabins on 3 passenger decks. So it's compared to ocean liners, it's a completely different sort of a boat. Not long after leaving Passau, we cruised through the Slidener Schlinge, also known as the Danube Bend. This is the largest river meander in Europe and a very picturesque stretch of the Danube. In fact, it was named a natural wonder of Upper Austria in 2008. What it is an epigenetic breakthrough valley formed as the Danube carves a meandering course through the soft tertiary layers and subsequently forced to maintain its channel on the hard granite rock. The later lifting of the landmass caused the Danube to carve a nearly 300 meter deep course into the earth, thereby creating the narrow meandering valley. We also went through three sets of locks. Watch it carefully, you can actually see the boat going down relative to the dock on the side. It's surprising how fast it goes. You can see the rate at which we're going down in the lock. It's about an inch a second, I would say. On arrival at Linz in Austria, we boarded a bus to take us 80 kilometers north across the border into the Czech Republic, into southern Bohemia in fact, to visit the picturesque southern Bohemian town of Český Krumlov. Now Bohemia was a duchy of Moravia in the 9th century and then part of the Habsburg monarchy and the Austrian Empire. Now it is the western region of the Czech Republic. Now the town of Český Krumlov is bisected by the meandering Vltava River and dominated by its 13th century castle and Gothic, Renaissance and Baroque style buildings. It's also the home of the Pivovar Eggenberg Brewery. Now this is Seskikromlov Castle grounds, which was built in 1240 by the Vitkovici family on a long rocky headland overlooking the Vltava River. This is the Cloak Bridge, built in 1764. It's a five-story high bridge over a deep carved moat filled with bears and connects the upper castle with the castle theatre buildings and gardens. And on the Cloak Bridge is the St. Wenceslaus statue. He was the Duke of Bohemia from 921 to 935. And of course, he's famous for the Christmas Carol. Here's a view over the town showing the 86-metre-high Castle Tower and the slightly smaller St. Josht Church with its green bulbous spire. The Castle Tower is considered the town symbol. It was originally built in the 13th century, but finalised in its present form in 1581. And this is St. Vitus Church, which we went inside to explore. We walked around the main square with its plain column and fountain. Then we explored the streets, alleyways, and rivulets of this picturesque town. We return to Linz, the third largest city in Austria, which dates back to Roman times when it was called Lentia. We just had time to go to the main square for Linzer Torte, a traditional Austrian pastry. Delicious. Then we were off down the Danube to Krems, passing through the picturesque Passau Valley, which is a 36 kilometer long valley and a source of high quality wines. This is the town of Dürnstein, meaning dry stone, and named after the castle overlooking the town. You can see the blue Dürnstein Abbey Church, built in 1372. However, the town is dominated by the ruins of Dürnstein Castle, built in 1192. King Richard I of England, also known as Richard the Lionheart, was held captive here by Leopold V of Austria after their dispute during the Third Crusade. The castle was destroyed by Swedish invaders in 1645. Further on downstream, we passed the town of Weissenkirchen and its parish church, followed by numerous vineyards. This is Krems, a small city on the Danube, 70 kilometers west of Vienna. First mentioned in the year 995. And here's our boat at the dock there. The main attraction near Krems is Gottvig Abbey, a Benedictine monastery located on Gottvig Mountain, 10 kilometers south of Krems, founded in 1083. And here is the Abbey Church. This is the Imperial Staircase fresco with an apotheosis of Charles VI by Paul Troger, built in 1739. And this is the view of the Passau Valley from the grounds of Gottvig Abbey. On the way from Krems to Vienna, we were entertained at dinner by Austrian folk singers. So here we are in Vienna, the national capital and cultural, economic and political centre of Austria. It is the second largest German-speaking city after Berlin, and it was founded in 500 BC. It is known as the City of Music, since it's the home of Mozart and Beethoven, and the City of Dreams, as it's the home of Sigmund Freud. It is also known for its high quality of life, equal first with Vancouver and San Francisco. This is Maria Theresienplatz, a large public square joining the Ringstrasse with the Museumquartier, dominated by the monument of the Empress Maria Theresa, the only female ruler of the Habsburg dynasty. Either side of the Platz are the Natural History Museum and the Art History Museum, both very similar buildings, and both built in 1899. From Maria Theresienplatz, we walk through the imposing city gate Burgtor, which dates back to the 1800s, to Heldenplatz, or Hero Square, a public square in front of Hofburg Palace, with two 1860s equestrian statues, this one of Prince Eugene. And this is the Neuburg Wing of Hofburg Palace, where Adolf Hitler's 1938 announcement of the Austrian Anschluss, or annexation, to Nazi Germany took place. We then walked through to Michaelerplatz, St. Michael's Place, built in 1889 to 93, and then down the inner city streets towards St. Peter's Church, at the end of the street with the green dome. Approaching St. Peter's Church, we turned right onto Graben Street, where you can see the plague column down there, which was erected in 1679. We ended up at Stephanplatz and the St. Stephen's Cathedral, or Stephansdom, which was first consecrated in 1147. The current church was built in the 14th century. This is the mother church of the Roman Catholic Archdiocese of Vienna. We then drove out to Schönbrunn Palace, which means beautiful spring, and the water comes from an artesian well on the property. This was the main summer residence of the Habsburg rulers. It has 1,441 rooms, and its history spans 300 years. And the grounds are quite delightful. From Vienna, we continued down the Danube River into Slovakia, to Bratislava. Now, Slovakia was originally part of Moravia in the 9th century, then Hungary, then part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire until World War I, when Czechoslovakia was created, and it became independent in 1993. Bratislava is the capital and largest city and occupies both banks of the Danube and the left bank of the Morava River. This is Bratislava Castle, positioned on a plateau 85 metres above the River Danube. It's been a stone castle since the 10th century, and it dominates the city. The Vienna Gate, built in 1712, is the main entrance to the castle grounds. And this is the Hillebrand building on the West Terrace, which was rebuilt after a fire in 1811. The traditional main gate of the castle leads through to the main castle entrance with a statue of Svatopluk, a 9th century Moravian ruler. And also from the honorary courtyard, you get a wonderful expansive view over the Danube. In particular, you can see the most SNP bridge and the distinctive UFO restaurant built in 2005 and 85 meters high. We walked into Bratislava Old Town through Michael's Gate, a gate through the medieval fortified city wall built in the year 1300. The gate was reconstructed in 1758 with the 51 metre high St. Michael's Tower, which you'll see in a few moments. The old town is quite picturesque, lots of cobbled streets and interesting stores. And unusual street sculptures. This is the main square of Bratislava, with the Old Town Hall, that's the Yellow Tower. And this is the Roland Fountain, built in 1572 as a water supply. It has a statue of Maximilian II on top. And here is the Ludovit Stur statue. He introduced the Slovak language in the 19th century. Then we went to Hvozdoslav Square, a 1,000-year-old square named after the 19th century Slovak poet. And here is the statue of Hvozdoslav. I hope I've got that right. He lived from 1849 to 1921. And finally, we saw the Slovak National Theatre, a neo-Renaissance style built in 1886. We then continued our trip down the Danube into Hungary, which was under Habsburg rule from the 18th century, then part of the Austro-Hungarian Empire until the end of World War I, when the Soviet Union took control, finally becoming an independent republic in 1989. This is the Esztergom Basilica, the seat of the Hungarian Catholic Church, 50 kilometres west of Budapest on the banks of the Danube. Budapest is the capital and largest city in Hungary. It sits on the site of the former Roman town of Aquincum. Hungarians arrived in the 19th century, but it was pillaged by Mongols in 1241. Ottomans ruled for 150 years from 1526, then it was the capital of the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Today, Budapest comprises two towns, Buda on the west bank, which is scenic and hilly, and Pest in the east bank, which is relaxed and a party town. They united in 1873. We arrived in the evening to a spectacular view of the well-lit city from our ship on the Danube. We docked in Pest, and you can see Buda Castle there in the distance. This is the view across the Danube from Pest to Buda, specifically the castle district. You can see the Szilágyi Dezső Square Reformed Church in the foreground, Fisherman's Bastion behind and overlooking the church, and Matthias Church, which is the spire on the horizon. This is Fisherman's Bastion, also known as Haller's Bastia, built 1895 to 1902, and named after the Guild of Fishermen in the Middle Ages who lived in this area and protected the castle walls. And here is the statue of St. Stephen, the first king of Hungary, in Fisherman's Bastion. There are some wonderful views across the Danube towards Pest from Fisherman's Bastion. Here we are looking north. And this is a good view of the Parliament building. And here you can see St. Stephen's Basilica in the distance and the Chechenyi Chain Bridge. This is the Szabad Hazert Monument, which means Free Motherland, a tribute to the Hungarian freedom fighters during the War of Independence against Austria. A major feature of the castle district is the Matthias Church, with the Holy Trinity statue in front. Originally built in 1015 by St. Stephen, the current building dates from the 14th century, but was extensively restored in the 19th century. Two Hungarian kings were crowned here. We went inside to have a good look around. And this is the close-up of the Holy Trinity statue, first built in 1706 as thanks for the cessation of plague. Also in the castle district is the Sandor Palace, the official residence of the president since 2003. It was built in 1806. Then we cross the Danube to Pest and Hero Square, which displays statues of the seven chieftains of the Magyars and memorial monument with Archangel Gabriel on the top. And we saw the Franz Liszt Academy of Music, the university and concert hall built in 1875. We then visited the Hungarian State Opera House, a neo-Renaissance style building dating from 1884. Gustav Mahler was the director here from 1888 to 1891. While inside, we were actually treated to a brief opera performance. Also in Pest, we went to the Jewish Quarter, which was initiated in the 18th century and became a Nazi ghetto during the 1944-1945 period. 70,000 Jews were relocated here. This is the Dahany Street Synagogue in the Jewish Quarter, the largest synagogue in Europe. It seats 3,000. It was built in 1859 in Moorish Revival style. In the Dahany Street Synagogue grounds is a Jewish cemetery containing 2,000 bodies from the Nazi era. There's also a memorial to the Hungarian Jewish martyrs. It resembles a weeping willow with the names of the victims on its leaves. 400,000 Hungarian Jews died. And on the banks of the Danube in Pest, there's a memorial called Shoes on the Danube Bank, to Jews massacred by the fascist Hungarian militia, also known as the Arrow Cross Party, during World War II. Jews were lined up by the river, told to remove their shoes, and then shot, so they fell into the Danube and were carried away downstream. We then visited St. Stephen's Basilica, a Roman Catholic basilica in honour of Stephen, the first king of Hungary, who reigned from 975 to 1038. Thank you. basilica contains St. Stephen's mummified right hand in a rather ornate reliquary. It also contains the Holy Crown of Hungary, also known as the Crown of St. Stephen, used from the 12th century to 1916. We drove 25 kilometres north from Budapest to the village of Zontondra on the west shore of the Danube to visit the Skansen Village Museum, an exhibition of Carpathian folk architecture and life, founded in 1967. While at the Skansen Village Museum, we learned how to make real Hungarian goulash. Zontondra Village is a picturesque, historic 19th century village known for its galleries and artists. Well, I hope you've enjoyed watching the presentation. That's all, folks. Bye for now.